Hi, I'm Michael Breed inside my MorganFranklin Transformation Center. Now, what are we doing? Well, we're giving you an exclusive insider tour of, well, not all of the technology that I have in here, but some of the technology that's assisting me with transforming people's golf games. So I want to show you what we're going to do. We're going to look at a video system that I have here, my V1 system, and we're also going to show you how this About Golf simulator works. So let me, first of all, turn on the camera and hit a little record here. I'm gonna make a golf swing, and what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna show you how I use this V1 system, okay? So I've got a 7-iron here. We'll just make a normal 7-iron swing. Okay, pretty good shot. Now, I'm gonna come over here and I'm gonna pull this up. And one of the things that I'm trying to do when I'm helping people is explain to them what's going on with the golf club. Well, one of the beauties that I have with the V1 system is I can draw lines on here. So that's what we call a shaft plane line. I can also draw a line on here, what we talk about hip depth, how the hips stay back in the golf swing. So then we start looking at what happens with this golf club, and you can see the slow motion that this records. So the head of the golf club is on top of the shaft plane line. I get up to the top here. One of the most important positions that I'm looking at the top of the swing is from the butt end of the golf club down to my shoulder. Is that line there parallel to my original shaft plane line? The answer is yes. So I'm very happy with that position. And also, too, my hips have created some depth there as well. Now we come down into the downswing. There's a little bit of drop, and then the body starts to go. And you can see I can control this golf club frame by frame. So now I'm back on the shaft plane line. Club comes down, strikes the ball. The shaft returns right back to the shaft plane line. So it's a very good golf swing. And also, too, by the way, my hips have maintained that depth. Now, that's how I'm using my V1 system. We come over here to the information that comes out of my About Golf simulator, and I start looking at what we call the numbers. What are the numbers? Well, the numbers are telling me this. I hit that 7-iron, it flew 164.5 yards in the air, and it stopped 165.5. So I only had about 3 feet of rollout, which means I had a good apex. And I look down here, my apex is 90 feet, and that's typically what I play at. And this helps people understand, hey, you know what? My 7-iron has the same height as my 4-iron. I know it, like many of you that are golfers don't understand that, but that's exactly what happens. These golf clubs all have the same apex. It just happens at different times in its distance from you. So I got a 90-foot apex. My launch angle, so when that ball took off, what was the angle that the ball took off at? It took off at a 20-degree angle. And it also took off about 1 degree to the right of the target. It still was a very, very straight shot, but it took off 1 degree to the right. So I might say, you know what, my start line wasn't exactly where I want it. I want that to start a little bit closer to center. So that might be something with aim, or it might be something with my swing, whatever it may be. I also get information on what the ball speed is, what the club head speed is. All of that information is coming out of just these two things. There's a whole lot of stuff that's taking place in my transformation center, and this is just two of the pieces of technology that I have in what we call the state-of-the-art MorganFranklin Transformation Center. Now, what we want to do is we want to make sure that everybody has the opportunity to improve best they can with technology that's available for us in this information center. Now, what I've got to do, I got to jump back on a call with my friends from MorganFranklin and Vaco here and see how they're using technology. And who better to do that with than MorganFranklin and Vaco's lead technology experts? All right. So I want to introduce you to two very important people, Wendy Liu, who is with Vaco, Managing Director for Technology with Vaco, and Geoff Harkness, who's MorganFranklin's Informational Management and Technology Lead. And I know you all, first of all, welcome. Thanks for the time today. It's good to see both of you. Wendy, let's start with you. You've seen how I'm using technology in the MorganFranklin Transformation Center, but I know technology is a really important thing for Vaco. How are you using technology to advance your team and advance your company?
Well, first of all, Michael, especially during this time, during the pandemic, we are utilizing, obviously, tools like Zoom and collaborative online sharing platforms to communicate not only within our teams, but with our consultants, with our candidates, with our clients, and just finding collaborative ways to get in touch with each other. We used to be out in the field 90% of our time going out to happy hours and lunches. And now we have a lot more platforms to allow us to create those type of experience, such as a virtual lunch, a virtual happy hour, and having platforms where you can deliver food items, drinks, spirits of their choice to our clients and be able to have that experience again during the past, six, 7 months without much disruption in our daily business.
All right. So, Geoff, give us an idea how you're using technology as MorganFranklin's information management technology lead. How are you using technology, and what technologies are you using?
Thanks, Michael. Great to see you again. We are using a number of technologies, which are many we were using sort of before the pandemic, but we're much more heavily reliant on those things to do a variety of things. We used to be focused on a lot of enabling technologies as an end result of what we're doing with and for our clients. Now we're much more reliant on using those things like web collaboration and other types of graphics and videos and other things to do some things that we used to do shoulder to shoulder, which are train, which are build relationships and to facilitate decision making, and things that were a lot more conducive to in-person, you know, contact and eye-to-eye physical conversations and working sessions. So those types of things are really, we're super reliant on those. And as much as we were before, we're even more reliant on our either our home, you know, desktops and laptops and devices that allow us to be connected and conduct business in a very mobile manner.
Are there things that you are doing in the technology world that are helping you bridge this two-dimensional space and getting into the three-dimensional space? Because as you mentioned, Geoff, and I'll let you start, we are trying to maintain still that same personal relationship, which it becomes more challenging when you're looking into a screen and you can't shake somebody's hand or give them a high five or do whatever to get past that professional business relationship and turn it into the personal relationship that I know is instrumental in your success.
I think that we have seen some interesting things happen and learned a lot of lessons, which were, we were very nervous about how that was going to work. And where we had an existing relationship, it was very easy. But where it came to building new rapport with a contact or a prospective client that we've never met before, and we don't have that level of trust. We might have a warm introduction from a trusted neutral third party, but that's still only, only gets you part of the way there. So at first, I think that we were hearing from everybody, our clients and others, that it was going to be a tough hill to climb to try to gain new market share or new clients. Because everybody was scared, quite frankly, and not really interested in sharing anything. They just wanted to make sure they were staying safe and staying whole. But then as things, you know, as we realized this wasn't a couple day, week phenomenon, I think that there was a bit of a turning point where people had to get things done. They had to take a little risk. They had to engage with others. And at the same time, people had been getting more used to the technology. So the next phase of that became, well, maybe I will put something behind me, either as a virtual, a manufactured background or something just strategically placed, or I'll move around the house. That will spark different conversation. So we're using those either contrived, manufactured ways to bring conversations in, or we're asking teams to wear their favorite hat or sports team or other, something obviously. Diversity and inclusion has become a big, much more amplified issue through this period of time too. So we're leveraging or building on that opportunity to ask people to share a little bit more about their heritage, their culture, and anything they are. So I think that maybe we're sharing a lot more than we thought we would be to make that a more intimate interaction between internal team members and prospects and existing clients.
As you look at all the bad, there's obviously some good that comes out of this. And as we start thinking about how to transform ourselves or reinvent ourselves in a way to improve in this new norm, whatever that may be, what are some of the things, Wendy, that you're doing within Vaco to kind of take advantage of the opportunities that exist?
I think a couple of parts here. Internally, within our Vaco technology team, we obviously utilize data, right? Everything's driven by data on how we can improve our experience with our clients, how we can better serve them, and how we can better take the top talent to the market. So we analyze a lot of data across the board on what our clients are, where their pain points are, what they're needing, what we're hearing. We stay very close to our clients, understanding what can help them drive their business based on industries and types of organizations. And the same thing with our clients, right? During this unprecedented time, everyone is figuring how to stay relevant, how to be the best they can to deliver for their clients. So any type of technology tools, be it implementing and actually starting, not just talking about artificial intelligence, bringing more RPA, process automation, to their organizations in order to best, again, serve their clients, right? Ultimately, it's about customer success and what you can do for your clients. So, and there's so much technology out there that companies are really looking to see what platforms, what software, like you in the golf world, what is really helping us drive success to the market and what is not. So a lot of technologies are being scrutinized right now, but at the same time, a lot of technologies are helping companies go much further.
Data is such an important thing when you start to really break stuff down and really get an understanding of what is the key to the performance. Wendy, I'll ask you, how have you used the analytics and the data in this period of time to help Vaco continue to prosper?
Yes, we're a very operationally driven organization as a whole. And I would say with our team, we don't necessarily micromanage, but we utilize the data in terms of the success that we can create for our clients. And we analyze that week after week, month after month. And in that, we can drive our business development teams and our account managers to achieve more success by seeing where and what types of solutions we have been designing for our clients, what types of resources have been overall a success for our clients. And we utilize that in order to redirect our sales wherever needed.
Geoff, I'll chuck it to you.
I think we've used a lot of different data. Obviously, there's data that is, you know, somewhat quantitative, somewhat qualitative, but everybody's trying to read the tea leaves on cases reported, number of tests, things around the pandemic, but then more importantly, trying to read the tea leaves with a very data-driven approach on tactical things like liquidity and forecasting and reforecasting of the business and what those drivers are of ability to continue to transact. There's a lot of enabling data that's within the four walls of companies or market data that is helping them with that. But then going into the more, you know, predictive side of things, it's just harnessing the power of, you know, quantum computing and other almost not quite unlimited, but almost unlimited computing power to be sifting through and analyzing and modeling different behaviors, different natural language responses that people are getting from their clients, customers, and prospective customers to really understand which way they are going, which way their buying habits are going to, you know, dictate, et cetera. And I think that everybody has to do that and is in varying degrees of maturity to be able to take advantage of that. And I think you and I talked before and I said, people are really in a good spot to do that, or they have scrambled with great abandon to try to get to that point and realizing that having deferred that having a robust data infrastructure and having really normalized and getting to reason a set of KPIs that are workable, or investing in modeling and data science, those who did not do that are really working hard to try to catch up.
That kind of brings us to this final question, and that is the marriage between the technology, the data, as well as the personal side of you know, the business, how we achieve all this. As you start to look forward, do you have any sort of final thoughts of what the future looks like, Geoff?
So I think it's just a matter of how to effectively use those enabling tools and to drive decisioning while still maintaining the human connection. So it's still having a balance, still, you know, relying on your gut instinct to some extent, but also not forgetting that all those things we talked about on the people side are the key, because if you can't motivate a team and they don't want to take the hill with you, whether you're in business and, you know, whether you're an instructor, a coach, or a consultant, all your best ideas, all your fanciest, you know, data and analysis and punchlines are going to be meaningless. You still got to be able to convey and communicate your ideas and your thoughts about how to motivate those folks and how to do that in an environment where you really are less in that 3D contact.
I can't thank you both enough for the time, for coming on and sharing the insights. Continued good fortune to both of you, and thank you so much.
Thank you, Michael.
Thank you, Michael. We really appreciate the opportunity and your facilitation. Thank you.
All right, there you have it. There's an insider look at the MorganFranklin Transformation Center, where every day I'm helping people all over the world transform their games. If you want more information, all you need to do is visit MorganFranklin.com/golf. I'm Michael Breed. Thanks so much for joining me.